writing from a hospital to a community nurse, or in this particular case, it is palliative care nurse. So if you look at the writing task here, it says the letter is being written to Alex, who is palliative community nurse at community health center. And what is the purpose of writing? So it says you need to outline the treatment that this patient has received. And so you have basically two sections of purpose here. One is to outline the treatment, and another is to request the palliative care nurse to do this five things: monitor outcomes of referral to social worker, assist attendance, monitor medications, advise on diet, and offer symptom management. Usually, whenever it is written to a nurse, it can be the information, the amount of information that you have within the task can be quite overwhelming. And that is the reason why I have chosen this task, to teach you all how to write good summary. Because when you have a lot of information, you really need to have a good way of summarizing the information that you have. Right? So do we all have the purpose clear? You are writing from a cancer service, a cancer hospital, to a palliative community nurse. I am sure all of you understand the meaning of word palliative, right? End of the life care. So the nurse who provides end of the life care is palliative community nurse. What do we want this nurse to do? The purpose is divided in five sections here, plus one more section, outlining the treatment. To outline means to brief them. To write a brief summary of something is to outline. Then monitor medication, provide dietary advice, and it says ongoing advice, which means it has already been given and you need to continue that. The nurse needs to continue that. Offer symptom management and support that may be relevant to the treatment that patient has received. And these two other aspects, monitoring or coordinating with social worker and assisting attendance at ambulatory care service. So now, keeping these five things in mind, we would read through the case notes and learn or choose information which will be required for the target reader. So whenever you are trying to select information, keep the reader in your mind. Once you have the reader in your mind, think, why am I writing to this reader? And what information would they need? For example, if they have to monitor medications, what information would they need about medication? If they have to provide symptom management and support, what information would they need about the symptom management? Okay. So you can see here, you have some background details of this patient, which includes their name, age, some social history, date of admission, and date of discharge. Then you have their social background. Now see, in this situation, you are writing the letter for the first time. That means the palliative community nurse does not know the patient already. They don't know the patient. So obviously from social background, you would have some information which would be relevant for the target reader. So you have some information about their social background here. The important piece of information here is financial difficulty, because his emotional status seems to be, not very apprehensive. He is anxious naturally because of having a cancer, but otherwise you can see there are no emotional issues as such. So financial difficulties will be important aspect for us to consider. And maybe why financial difficulties, because of being unemployed, would be an important point to consider. Then this letter is being written to a palliative care nurse, so that makes sense that the patient must be having cancer. We are writing from cancer hospital. So here it is given that they have lymphoma, B-cell lymphoma, which was diagnosed in 2011. You are writing this letter in 12. Now, they have received chemotherapy, 6 cycles of chemotherapy. This is an acronym for the group of medications that is usually given in chemotherapy. Now, whenever you are writing from hospital to a palliative care nurse, or whenever you are writing from hospital to community nurse, obviously the patient might have been, or you know, admitted with a certain disease condition, or they may have been admitted with because of having a planned surgery. Okay, so here, because they have mentioned here they were admitted with the symptoms, and then the chest x-ray was done, which gave you a diagnosis that is community acquired pneumonia. So see, this kind of task can be a bit tricky, because you may think that the symptoms are important to mention, to give them the reason as to why the patient was admitted. But think of the time when you're writing this letter. You're writing this letter when the patient is being discharged and the diagnosis has been confirmed. So in cases where you are writing to a nurse who is not responsible for making diagnosis, and when you are writing at a point of time where those problems probably have resolved, and that is why the patient is being discharged from the hospital. So here, it would be very, very important for you to learn how to write a good summary. So this is one area where we are going to practice summarizing technique. Then the treatment that was given to them. So see, this is also related to the hospitalization. So the IV fluids, antibiotics, and the patient improved. They were seen by a dietitian. High protein diet has been started. And this is quite interesting here, that they were scheduled for the next cycle, but the patient has refused it. So this helps us understand why are we writing this letter to palliative care nurse, right? So one way of, or one reason for writing to palliative care nurse would be poor prognosis. And another could be when the patient doesn't, wish to have further aggressive treatment, and therefore you just decide to give palliative or symptomatic treatment, although they both are very different from each other. But here, of course, because if they don't take further chemotherapy, it would not be symptomatic treatment, but it would become palliative care. And then you have assessment here. So this assessment gives you information about their current status. What is their current status? So they are fully mobile, but obviously they tire very easily. They can manage their activity of daily living on their own, so that's not a problem. Appetite is good. What is important for us here is this portion, that if they develop any of the symptoms, then they should be sent back to hospital. So this is important for the nurse, because she needs to keep an eye on for the symptoms. So that, because one of the purpose also tells you that she is supposed to offer symptomatic treatment and management. So this is important point to cover. Here, they don't have any issues in terms of mobility. They don't have any issues in terms of activity of daily living. So those are the points which you can completely skip, because it is no longer a problem. Then about the discharge plan. So whenever, as a nurse or as a doctor, the discharge plan that you develop, this is quite tricky, okay? Be very, very careful when you are interpreting the discharge plan. So a lot of students have this belief that if it is a discharge plan, that means all these things will be done by the person we are writing the letter to. That's partially correct. Discharge plan is something which you develop as a registrar or as a nurse, as when the patient is being discharged. And then when they are discharged, it may happen that some of the things you have done already and some of the things you want them to continue doing. Now, when it comes to referrals to other healthcare professionals, 99% of the time, all the referrals are done from the hospital itself. Okay, so I'll show you why in this also it is very clear that the referrals have been done. Here you can clearly see seen by a dietitian. That means this referral has been completed already. Now you can see here antibiotics. So we know that the nurse is supposed to monitor medication. So she must know what medications are to be given. We are going to write details of medication along with the dosage and frequency. Now here pay attention to the verb. It says advised. That means this has already been done. What advice have we given? To contact palliative care team for support and symptom relief. So we advised the patient, but we're also writing a letter to palliative care team. So this kind of bullet points can trick you, okay? Because this is something which you have already done. The past tense helps you to understand that these are the things which have been done, whereas the rest of the things where you do not see past tense may be the things that you want the nurse to do. So if you look at the next point, it says referral to social worker regarding this RE. If it is written in the case notes, it means regarding. So why the referral is to be given? For financial matters and family support. Now, here you don't see clearly whether it has been done or whether they need to do it. But as I told you, it is a rule of thumb that whenever a patient is discharged from the hospital, and if any of the referrals are to be done, they are done from the hospital itself. If those referrals are to be done later on, then it would be mentioned, in that way. It would say physiotherapist to refer the patient to someone, GP to refer the patient to dietitian. If that is not mentioned, consider that those referrals are to be done by you or by your team, even if it is in the discharge plan. And here we have the evidence of it, right? Here if we see in the things that the nurse needs to do, it is given that monitor outcomes. So she is not supposed to refer the patient. She's just supposed to monitor the outcome of referral to social worker. Outcome is the result, which again helps us clarify our doubt that the referral to social worker is something that we have done. Follow-up hematology ambulatory care service. So the patient needs to follow up, and it is given that the nurse can assist the patient if required. And appointment for blood counts. So this is also, the next appointments are also always arranged by the hospital itself. So here also it is already arranged. So when you are putting forward, the information of discharge plan, it's the accuracy and the tense that you choose is very, very important. For example, if you will say appointment will be scheduled, that will be grammatically wrong because appointment has already been scheduled or the appointment is scheduled. That's the right tense that you can use. Right? So now we have got a tentative framework as to what points are we going to put in our referral letter and what points are we going to exclude. There are a very few details which we can exclude here. For example, these points we may not need to write as it is, but we may need to summarize it in our own words. And that is something I highly recommend. There is a difference between paraphrasing and summarizing. Paraphrasing means you are writing everything that is given without skipping anything. You're just using different language. And summarizing means you write it in your own words and you may skip minute details by highlighting the main point. So here, you may not need to use the exact word, he's burden on family, but you can put it in a way where you can convey the main idea that he's mainly worried about the expenses of the treatment and that is probably the reason why he has discontinued. It is given here, appears calm and understands prognosis and care plan, wishes to remain at home with access to community care. So whenever a person chooses to go for a palliative care, they have two alternatives. Either they can shift into a full-fledged palliative care homes, or if they don't want to be in palliative care homes, if they want to be with their family during the end stage of their life, then they are also allowed to stay at home and the community care is provided at their home. So I hope everyone has got a clearer idea as to how we are going to put forward this story to the palliative community nurse. Now let me ask you some basic questions about this. Let us start right from the introduction paragraph. What points will I include in the introduction paragraph? What points would I include in the introduction paragraph? Usually we write the disease condition and the purpose. Now here we have two disease conditions. We have the progressive disease that they have, the cancer, and you have community acquired pneumonia. So in your hospital, the patient was admitted because of pneumonia. But you are writing this letter for palliative care nurse. So which diagnosis would you put in? Would you put in DLBCL in the introduction paragraph? Or would you put in community acquired pneumonia? Okay, so that's great to know all of you have been saying DLBCL. Yes. Yeah, because I need to rationalize palliative care. If I use community acquired pneumonia as diagnosis, I won't be able to rationalize why the patient then needs palliative care. Yeah, so that's correct. So if I'm going to include those two things in my introduction paragraph, yes, obviously the purpose, we will not mention purpose in detail in the introduction paragraph. We are gonna mention the overall purpose that it is for palliative care, or it is for comfort care, end of the life care, respite care. So those are the two things which we are going to include in the introduction paragraph. Now, if an introduction paragraph, if I'm putting forward this point, the DLBCL, what would I write in the second paragraph? What would I write in the second paragraph? Assessment? Which assessment? About the details of DLBCL? Okay. Now, if I write about the details of DLBCL, let us see how much information do we have here. Medication which are given, Krishna, but the medication are given for pneumonia, not for DLBCL. So again, sweating and dyspnea, funky, are not the symptoms of DLBCL. But these are not the symptoms of DLBCL. Do you all realize that? Yeah. It is, lymphoma is a kind of blood cancer, and here they were admitted because of community-acquired pneumonia. So logically, why community-acquired pneumonia? Because they were on chemotherapy, which might have suppressed their immune system, which has then resulted in secondary infections. So these symptoms are not of DLBCL. Neither the treatment that we gave is for DLBCL. So what would I include in second paragraph? Yes. Yeah. So what I would have to do is, I would have to mention the treatment that was given to them for DLBCL, and I would have to mention that they have refused for the treatment. Okay. Now, what if I do this way? Because see, in introduction, if I would just leave by saying they have DLBCL, okay, let me do this way, DLBCL, and the purpose, which is palliative care. And in the second paragraph, what I would write is, I would write about the 6 cycles that they have received so far, and denial for the treatment. Apologies for the spelling errors. Okay. So, what would I write in my third paragraph in that case? Third paragraph. Discharge plan. So wouldn't I at all mention about community acquired pneumonia? Then how would I tell them to provide symptomatic treatment? We will. Yeah. So where would I write? Where would I write about the community acquired pneumonia? Can I write that summary in third paragraph? third paragraph. Yeah, pneumonia as a complication of chemo. Yeah, that we all do realize. Now, yeah, so what we would have to basically do here is in third paragraph, we would need to summarize the details. Yeah, we need to mention why they were admitted. We need to mention what treatment has been given to them. We need to tell them how has their progress been. And we also need to tell them what should they do if the symptoms return. Okay. And you also have some details about hospitalization. So all these points, which now I'm going to mark with this star, will be included in third paragraph. The reason for admission. So not the symptoms though, the reason for admission, treatment that was given to them, how is their condition now, and here, what, when they need to return, and the medications that they need to continue after being discharged. This is one way. One way could be this, where I can include all the details about hospitalization in the third paragraph, which will be reason for admission, then detail of treatment, the discharge, medication, and current condition. Okay. Then in fourth paragraph, what would be right in the fourth paragraph? Diet. Yeah, I can write about diet, but that's just one sentence, isn't it? Just one sentence that he needs to take high protein diet, that's all. Yeah, so let us see here. Maybe seeing discharge plan would help you. Seeing the purpose would help you. Let me show you the purpose. So here is the purpose. It says they need to monitor outcome of referral to social worker. They need to attend, or they need to help them attend ambulatory care service, and they need to offer symptom management and support. What would I write in fourth paragraph? So we are going priority wise, right? This was our priority, DLBCL. We have written about the admission. Now what is left? social care service and next appointment. Yeah. So fourth paragraph will be now about, you know, as we move forward, it will be, you know, less, like gradually we will move on to less important information. So fourth paragraph will be about social circumstances. And here we need to tell the nurse. The nurse is supposed to liaise with the social worker. So they would need to know a little bit of social background as well. So this is also going to be a very good, very, very good practice for all of us to write a good summary, right? For paragraph number 3 and paragraph number 4, because we have quite a lot of information here, which we need to summarize. And fifth paragraph, or it could be a very short line, which is going to be about the follow-up appointments. I would not put it with social circumstances because the ideas with same you know, issues should be put together. So it could affect my score in organization and layout if I put social circumstances along with follow-up appointments. So I'll try to group them separately. That's again very, very important for all of us to consider. Okay, so we have got a tentative structure here. Now let us start writing. Particularly we want to practice for third and fourth paragraph, but still let us write all of them so that I get to know how capable are you to put things into paragraphs. And I just wanted to know if are you all okay if I have put this much information on screen? Are you all okay with that? Because I suppose here what you have is mainly the repetition of things that the nurse needs to do. And here you have the name of the patient and their admission date. So maybe I can do it this way as well. Right now I'm having this much of information. Once you have picked up the name and age, as well as the admission date. Admission date again is not something very, very important here because see, you are writing to a palliative care nurse and it's the admission has nothing to do with the surgery or anything like that. So if it was a surgery, it would have been important for us to tell when the surgery was performed so the post-operative care can be organized accordingly. So here I don't think it would make a huge difference whether you write the date of admission or not. That is going to be fine. But it would be a good idea to start third paragraph with date of admission. So that gives them a clear timeline as to when they developed community acquired pneumonia and, you know, how is their situation now. So I recommend third paragraph if you can start with the date of admission. Okay, so now I want all of you to start typing your responses. And what I am going to do is we are going to write the letter in collaboration. Okay. So what I'm going to basically do is I'm going to put up your write-up here on the Word file that I'm sharing. And then I want you to visualize, you know, how it the whole letter looks like. And then I'm going to show you how would we compare it with the model answer and how would we use model answer to learn the correct way of writing. Again, as I told you, model answer is not, you know, something which can be written in just one way. Okay? There can be multiple ways of writing it. So all of you start typing in now so that I can help you with your sentence structure as well. Start typing introduction paragraph. And I want all of you to take this notes, this 5 points, so that I can take it off now and I can start putting the letter here. Okay? So please take notes of this 5 paragraphing that we have decided, the 5 points. and now start writing introduction paragraph. Remember, you are writing to someone who doesn't know your patient already. So you may need to, or you may like to put a who sentence, or you may like to put appositive, the way we write an electrician or a lawyer or a student. So that could be helpful, particularly when they are going to be, so close working with the patient. They are going to be working very close with the patient. Now, as you can see, the discharge plan, they have to take care of a lot of aspects of the patient's care, which also includes the social aspect of patient's care. So it would be a good idea to put an appositive there, an electrician or, something like that, which helps them understand the patient's social background. Okay, so now I'm taking this off. And what I'm going to do next is, as you guys start typing in, I'm going to put forward your write-up here. Yes, you all need to type it in the chat box. So what I'm going to basically do here is, I'm going to compare different answers with you, and I'm going to give you my feedback on, and all of you also will be, allowed to give your feedback on what do you think is more appropriate way of writing. So this is going to be a quite interesting session for all of you. Try to write compound and complex sentences. Compound sentences are the sentences when you want to convey to the target reader that both the piece of information that you are writing in one sentence are equally important. And complex sentence you would use when you want to convey to the target reader that, one idea is more important than the other idea. Regarding the use of acronyms, I would strongly recommend that you minimize the use of acronyms. You want me to move it up, down? Which portion do you want to see? Just let me know. Up. Is it now visible, the full discharge plan? I've got right from the social background, the electrician, all those things fall into the social background. Then you have the discharge plan. And if you want to see this part, the nurse, what she needs to do, this is the part that she needs to do. And here, you want to see the details of the patient, name, age, admission date. Yeah, that is also fine. If you directly start with second para, that's fine. Okay, a lot of grammatical errors here, Nikita. I'll show you why. So you don't need to write full name of the patient because we would be writing that in the reference part, the RE line. Then the spelling of referring is wrong. You need. And if you want to use this format, then the correct way of writing, see, when it comes to writing articles, a and the, they cannot be written in between the adjective and noun. So the right sentence here would be, who is of 44. Now, when you want to use age as an adjective, you need to separate it with hyphen and you keep your singular, you don't make it plural. So this is the right sentence. I'm referring Mr. Ortega, who is a 44-year-old unemployed electrician. He has had DLBCL since 2011, and this is again an error because see, if you have just two sentences, he has had, this is your one part, and he is being discharged is your second part. So if you have just two sentences to connect, you rather use and. And is being discharged now. Into palliative care would also be slightly wrong. Into is used you know what meaning this conveys? It conveys the meaning that this patient is probably going somewhere, not at their home. So it would be much better if you would rather say he is being discharged with palliative care from your department. That would give them a clear idea that they are being discharged at home, but the nurse needs to support. And see, remember, this is a very important point for all of you to know. If you are using age as an adjective, okay, this is how you put it. You don't make plural of your and you separate it with hyphen. But in this case, I don't think it is important to mention date, age, because again, it is something you would be writing in the referral part. So you could have simply said an unemployed electrician. Okay. And how you could have made this introduction paragraph much better is by removing this who is here and putting it here. Because in that case, you would be able to summarize it within two sentences. With two sentences, you would be able to write your summary. I'm referring Mr. Ortega, an unemployed electrician who has had DLBCL since 2011. In that case, I wouldn't be able to add and here. I would rather make a new sentence. He is being discharged. Right? So when do I use So this helps me to give an introduction very clearly. An unemployed electrician who has had DLBCL. Okay, let me check out other answers. We're going to see which one is the best introduction paragraph in terms of conciseness and clarity. Both. Mr. Ortega. So here also we don't need full name, just Mr. Ortega. This is a good way to start because see, basically this is not a referral. I'm not writing for further investigations. I'm not writing for expert opinion. So it's perfectly fine to skip that I'm writing or I'm referring. You can simply start with the patient's name. But here, an unemployed who? Unemployed is an adjective. So I just can't say unemployed. Unemployed men, unemployed women, in this case, electrician. Just adjective cannot be used. You need noun and adjective both. And if you are connecting this, then why would you need and here? Because see, this is your additional information. So would you say Mr. Ortega and was admitted? This is a lot of grammatical error in this sentence. A lot of grammatical errors because of unnecessary use of commas. Do not make things complicated. You have made it complicated. So this is entirely one phrase to give further information. So if you are using this relative clause here, then it should directly go, Mr. Ortega was admitted with pneumonia. Now, here you need a new sentence. He is now being discharged today. So this grammatically, this is very poor paragraph. Very, very poor. Lot of grammatical errors. So when you are starting a sentence with a noun, okay, and if you are adding an sentence or who sentence, those sentences are just further information about that patient. So they act as flesh. But your main sentence should continue. So if Mr. Ortega is the subject, you need verb. Here in this case, Mr. Ortega is object. So you need verb to complete it. So now your sentence is complete here. And then you start a new sentence. And it really doesn't make sense if somebody says, he's being discharged today and he needs palliative care. Doesn't make sense. Because it is self-contradictory. Being discharged and needs palliative care. See, look at it as how the reader will find it. Look at it from reader's perspective. If you were the one to receive this letter, what message would you get? Okay, I have one more here. Let me get it here. I'm writing this letter to refer Mr. Ortega, who is a known case of DLBCL since 2011. Okay, so this sentence is grammatically correct, but I would refrain from using this kind of information because always remember that, when you are writing a referral letter, your patients are going to read probably first than anyone else. So refrain from using known case of term because it is offending. It may offend your patient because they are not just a case, they are a human being. So do not use this term. Instead of that, use non-judgmental term who has had DLBCL since 2011. So all of you remember this. As far as possible, avoid using words like a known case of. They are not a case, they are a human being. And age may not be necessary because you are already writing it in the RE section. So we, you know, the words are really scarce. You have to complete the whole letter in no more than 200 words. So we avoid repetition. So do not include age in the introduction paragraph since we are already mentioning it in the reference part. And the reference part is not calculated in the word count, whereas introduction paragraph is calculated in the word count. So do not include age in the introduction paragraph. But the main error here, Dr. Hitanshu, is the purpose of writing is not clear. Referral for what? What do you want them to do? Do you want them to confirm diagnosis? Do you want them to provide treatment? Do you want them to, you know, what do you want them to do? It's important to mention purpose clearly in the introduction paragraph. Okay, and I've got one more here. Okay, so if you want to go with this format, you would need comma here as well. The entire who clause would need bracketing comma, comma on both the sides of who clause for palliative treatment. Mr. Gabriel for, okay, Mr. Ortega it should be, because we refer to them by their second name. And instead of saying who was diagnosed with, it would be better to say who has DLBCL. Since you're not mentioning the year here, it would be fine to say who has. If you are mentioning a specific year, you need present perfect tense. Okay. So now, we have seen different varieties of introduction paragraph. Now let us compare this introduction paragraphs with the introduction paragraph from the model answer. And let us see how it differs, okay? Or how probably it could be an easier way to summarize information. This is how you use model answers to learn good summarizing techniques. Okay, so can you all see here the model answer? I would just look at the model answer here. You can see Mr. Ortega, who has diffuse large B-cell lymphoma. What I recommend for the acronyms is when you are writing acronyms to a specialist, that's fine because you know, the specialist would be aware about it, the endocrinologist or the oncologist, for example, or the hematologist. Would be able to understand. But when you are writing to a nurse who is more responsible for, you know, generalized care, they may be dealing with so many different conditions. So it would really be difficult for them to, you know, get a quick idea of what is DLBCL. So keeping, even if you will refer to the official criteria, it does mention that you should use acronyms only in those situations where you think your reader would be familiar with those acronyms. So you don't expect the nurse to be familiar with this acronym. So I would rather use full name. Or what you can do is, in such cases, if the name is too long, here after the name you can mention the short form, and then throughout your letter, instead of repeating the same name, you can refer to it as short form. So once if it is mentioned as a full form, and you know the short form in the bracket, and later on if you use short form, that would be fine. Yeah, so look at this paragraph here. What we did basically is we also included the chemotherapy as well, because how would I rationalize palliative care? Okay. So you can see here the summary with the help of complex sentence. We have two complex sentences here. Mr. Ortega, who has had diffuse B cell lymphoma since 2011, this is an additional sentence, so you need comma on both the sides, has received 6 cycles of chemotherapy so far. As now he has refused further aggressive treatment, he is being referred to you for respite care. So discharge is not very much relevant here, since in my introduction paragraph also I'm not mentioning if they are being admitted or not. So again, you know, don't feel this is not the one way. I'm just trying to show you how you can summarize the information. So what we had ideally decided is that we are going to put the chemotherapy in the second paragraph. So this would reduce, or I wouldn't need second paragraph now entirely dedicated to chemotherapy. And then simply here, you can, it also makes sense why they need respite care. Okay. It's because, not because of the poor prognosis, but because they have refused further treatment. So this is how you can use model answers to compare your summarizing techniques. Okay. So now in case if we had written such an introduction paragraph, what would we write in the second paragraph is we would write about his treatment, that although he has received 6 cycles of chemotherapy so far, he has now refused further treatment. So that would be just one sentence. Now I want all of you to write third paragraph. Again, think of a good summary. Try to skip minute details, try to focus on main ideas. So I'll just highlight the bullet points that you need to cover in third paragraph. So third paragraph, we can start with the admission date, and after that, the treatment that was given to them. Do I need to include the findings of X-ray? Would I need to say what the chest X-ray revealed? No. Yeah, because the patient is now being discharged. And what if I was writing this letter to patient's GP? If I was writing this letter to patient's GP, yeah, so in that case, we would include, right? So depending on the target reader. Although even when I'm writing to patient's GP, I can skip symptoms completely, because pneumonia itself would be enough to explain the symptoms. Yeah. And I would also, for nurse, I would skip the findings of the X-ray as well. Okay. So the points that you need to cover in third paragraph include, why were they admitted in the hospital? What treatment was given to them? And what is their current situation. So here it says they have improved. We can also include the dietitian portion in the same paragraph because it is something that was done in the hospital. Okay, and what the nurse should do if the symptoms return. Or alternatively, what you can do is you can divide this paragraph or this information into two separate paragraphs. One paragraph about what was done in the hospital and their progress, and one paragraph you can write about what is to be done in future, in which you can include the symptom management and treatment. So now start writing the summary of third paragraph, including these points. So let us try both the way. Let us first try including everything in third paragraph, the medications as well. Go ahead, start typing in the chat box. Kishan and Pankti, also try to send your responses so that I can get to know exactly where you stand and what are the improvements that you need. No, you don't need to mention the symptoms. The symptoms that they came in with, but what symptoms should the nurse watch for? There are two options. One way is you can mention exactly the symptoms, or another way is, because they are a nurse, a medical professional, we can give them a hint as to in which situation they should refer the patient. So if they have temperature, sweats, dyspnea, it would again indicate a relapse, or it would indicate a recurrent episode. So both the ways you can do. You can exactly mention the symptoms, or you can give the nurse a hint as to in which situation the nurse is supposed to send the patient back to the hospital. They should be able to clearly understand when to send them back because they are responsible for offering symptom management. So again here error, as and for which, you don't need both. Why would I say had been recommended, has been recommended? Because he still needs to do it, isn't it? And dexamethasone is a chemical name, so you don't need capital there. For augmentin duofort, you need capital for each word. And complains is wrong word. Please ensure compliance with the medication. And I would rather, instead of saying have been prescribed, I would rather say should be continued, because we have written that they were given all this treatment in the hospital as well.
So okay, ma'am.
Selecting appropriate verb plays an important role. You can't every time use word prescribe for medication.
Okay, ma'am.
Read model answers, Krishna. You are very weak in grammar. I can see restrictions in the language. You need to expose yourself more to the language.
Okay, ma'am. I will try.
Okay, how about others? I have been just waiting. Let me know once you have done. You can now start writing third paragraph, fourth paragraph, Krishna.
Okay, ma'am.
So had been is used if you want to say that it was only in the past and now it doesn't need to be done. But has been would indicate that it needs to be done in the present as well, right? Present perfect tense. So we use present perfect when we want to convey that it has to be done right now as well.
Yes, ma'am. I wrote has in my notebook, but in hurry by mistake.
Then it is fair enough. I'm happy that you understand the use. That's more important. We have another example here. Yes, a very good use of complex sentence, because of community-acquired pneumonia. His condition was improved. Instead of saying was improved, I would say has improved, because I'm connecting it with present, isn't it? Was improved would not give me any information about their current situation. Has improved will link it to present. Yeah, again, a very good use of complex sentence. So this is how complex sentences help you to summarize information. Okay, he will require oral antibiotics. And readmission will be considered as a single word, so you would need hyphen. And in formal writing, we don't use this way. Instead of that, you would use such as. And here, high temperature, sweats, and here you would say or dyspnea reoccur, because you're saying if any of these symptoms, okay? So when you all of you pay attention to this, whenever you are trying to put words together using comma, the last word has to be connected using and or. But here we are trying to say not if all of them, but even either of it. So whenever you want to say if, or whenever you are using negative, then the last word will be connected with or rather than and. Okay, so a very good summary. This is an example of a very good summary. And I've got it here from Nikita's task now. Okay, so see here, instead of using and, it would be better to use due to. Why was he admitted? Due to community acquired pneumonia. As a side effect of, it is not a side effect, but secondary to, or it is not a side effect of DLBCL. And I don't think it is important to link it also. You can simply say community acquired pneumonia. Okay, because we have in the introduction paragraph itself, we have mentioned that they have received chemotherapy. So that conveys the idea. So it's not necessary for me to again link it here. Just enough to say due to community acquired pneumonia. Okay, so see, this is the place where you can use complex sentence by saying after receiving treatment with IV fluids and antibiotics, his condition has improved. And okay, the dietitian, again, you would not say had advised, has advised. Regarding diet, but what type of diet? Regarding what type of diet? How would the nurse know what diet has been advised? See, this is very, very important from purpose point of view, from content point of view. You would lose mark if you don't mention which type of diet. Put yourself in target reader's shoes. If you were the one to receive this, wouldn't you question yourself, what type of diet should he take? What would I monitor? Okay, this sentence is appropriate, but for fentanyl, you would not need capital, not even for dexamethasone. And while you are writing the medications, you would need to use comma to separate medication from its dosage. Okay, here also 2 milligram, and here you would need and. This is very common error that all of you have been making. If you want to connect many nouns with comma, then the last noun is to be connected with and. You can't connect it with comma. And I have one more summary here. Let me get it on screen. This is Dr. Hitanshu's summary. He has been started on will confuse the reader a little bit. Because if I say he has been started on augmentin, they'll get confused as to the 7 days have ended or they still need to continue. So better statement here would be he has been advised to continue or he has been advised to take. That would give more clarity to the target reader. See, these are very minute points that you need to consider. He has been advised to continue or he has been advised to take. High protein diet. Yes. So while using if sentence, it is also a complex sentence when you use if. So the same rules that we used for complex sentences apply here as well. After writing the dependent sentence, you put a comma. Okay, so again, a very good example of summary, just one error in terms of appropriate verb selection. And here it's important to mention tablet or oral augmentin viewport. Yes. So if you compare all these summaries, right, the two examples that I said are good. You can see it is mainly because of the combination of sentence structures where you have compound sentence, you have complex sentence, you have picked up. It was good that all of you were able to leave out minute details, and that is because we decided it before writing the summary. But now can you think if what would have happened if we had included all these details? It would have become too long a paragraph. And in the last summary that we just saw, one thing is missing, that is his overall progress. How has been his overall progress? So that is something you need to consider. Okay, now let us compare it with the model answers paragraph. Yeah, okay, we also have one more summary here. Let me get that also. Okay, so I highly recommend that all of you refer to difficult words video that is in the grammar section, complain and complaint. Okay, and if you are using patient, you would need the patient because you are talking about a specific patient. Complaint of, complain is a noun. When you use it without T, it is noun verb, and here you need a noun form. So noun form is with T. In difficult words video, I have explained you in detail how to use complain and complaint differently in the sentence. And look at this sentence. This is grammatically wrong. IV fluids and antibiotics with normal saline. That means you have both the plural nouns. Okay? So has administered is wrong. Were administered. Were administered. Has administered is active voice. Let me give you a few examples. If I say, I have administered, I have administered or I have applied pressing. So when you use have, has, and ed, it is active voice. What you are trying to use here is passive voice. You are not saying who did it. Yes, your sentence is starting with what was done rather than who did it. So IV fluids and antibiotics were administered. As a result, his progress was satisfactory. I would rather say is satisfactory because I'm connecting it with present. If you have any complaint, who have? The nurse? If the nurse gets temperature, she should go to the hospital? Is that you are trying to convey? This is what I understand from what you have written. If he has, here also you need T, complaint. Instead of regarding, I would say, such as. And as I said, if you want to say if any of this is present, you should connect it with or. And means they should send only if all of them are present. What you are trying to convey is if any of these complaints are present. And oral antibiotics, which antibiotics should I give Pankti? Any antibiotics for next 7 days? This is not the right way to write. You will score very poorly in the content criteria because the reader wouldn't understand which medication. How would they monitor medication if they don't know which medication is the patient supposed to take? So from content point of view, you would lose mark here. And from grammar point of view, the error in using active or passive voice correctly. Instead of using too many linkers, see here you have used linker for every sentence. If you could have used complex sentence here. Although his progress has been satisfactory, or although he has made good progress, please send him back or please watch for these symptoms and refer him back to the hospital. Or although he has made good progress, he needs to continue this medications. Or you could have said, after being treated with IV fluids and antibiotics, he has made good progress. Okay, so they can be really, really helpful in highlighting the main issue. Okay, if everyone is done, let us compare it with model answer. You will have some changes there because we have, it's okay. We are going to look at it from a good summarizing techniques point of view. So as I told you, one way of paragraphing is you can write two things separately, the things which were done in the hospital and the things which are to be done after discharge. So he was admitted due to community acquired pneumonia for which he was treated with this and he was advised a particular kind of diet. He has progressed well and his condition is stable. So here also one sentence would be okay. Okay, if you just say he has progressed well, that's enough. After being discharged today, now what he needs to do, he needs to continue these medications. So another way in which you can connect too many nouns is by using in addition to, as well as, you are requested to monitor his medication compliance. So see here, I used a compound sentence. Can you see that? And refer him back to the hospital if he develops recurrent infection. So either of the way, even if you mention symptoms, that is perfectly fine. It will be much easier for the nurse to then pick up it. Okay. But here, considering that the target reader is nurse, if I write recurrent infection, it would be, as she would be able to understand, what do I mean by that? So This is how we use a combination of compound and complex sentence. And here I added the other referrals as well. So this is basically how I summarized this information. Is I compiled all the issues or all the things that are need to be done after discharge, and I separated social issues from that. Right? Can you see here the summary of social issues? So just a brief sentence about his background. He's worried about the expenses as he has lost his job. Therefore, so here a use of linker. He has been referred to social worker. So see here I had a combination of both the structures. We did chronology wise as well as problem solution, a combination of it. Because here I was mentioning the medication. So along with that, I also mentioned what the nurse needs to do about it. Okay, and instead of just mentioning that he needs to visit, I mentioned that if they need to support them, they can. If he needs support, then they can. So that is why, please accompany him during the follow-up if required. I've mentioned in the beginning itself, if required. And here again, I used a complex sentence with a relative clause, as well as at registrar review, which is scheduled on. So this is what I was saying, present tense should be used here. So content is should be very, very clear. If there is appointment, you should mention exactly when is the appointment, for what is the appointment. So complex sentence doesn't mean you write very lengthy sentences, right? If you try to write very lengthy sentences, you are likely to make more mistakes. Complex sentence is the normal way of writing English. So as you will expose yourself to more and more English, you will realize, how naturally we use complex sentences. It's not something you have to purposefully do it. So it's natural way in which you write sentences in English. Okay, so I hope this was a good exercise for all of you to learn summarizing technique. Okay, so Nikita has already sent fifth paragraph. He has referred to social worker is wrong. He has been referred to social worker. Last week we had session on, I suppose last to last week, present perfect tense, right? So has referred means active voice. It means the patient referred to someone. What we are trying to convey is we referred him to someone. So he has been referred to social worker. So then in that case, Nikita, the last sentence will not be required. He don't want to be a burden on his family. So see, this is the difference between paraphrasing and summarizing. Paraphrasing means you convert everything, into your own words. No, OET writing is not about paraphrasing. OET writing is about summarizing. Writing it in your own words, not converting every bullet point into a sentence, rather understanding, picking up 5-6 bullet points, grouping them, and then writing it in your own words, keeping the target reader in mind, what they need to know. So what they need to know basically here is what medication is the patient supposed to take, what symptomatic treatment they have to provide, what assistance, what kind of assistance they need to provide. With whom do they need to collaborate or coordinate with further support? So always keep the target reader in mind when you are writing. And as you would practice more and more, automatically, you know, both the ways should be done. Do not just, you know, one task is so much more important. You do not just write one letter and go ahead with the second task. No. From one task, you can learn so many things. For example, when you learn, you know, when you are picking up a task from beginners, first select information for yourself, then group information, then write the letter, then compare it with the model answer to see whether you chose right information, whether you were able to group the information appropriately, whether you were able to use compound, complex, and linker. All of that should be there. It does, and again, complex sentences doesn't mean very long sentences. Do not complicate them. So use of linker, use of compound sentence, use of appropriate time markers, appropriate tenses, a combination of all that will give you a good summary. So writing is something which requires a lot of practice, and that is the reason why you have been given that step-by-step process of writing. And it's very, very important that you analyze one letter. Do not just give it up and move on to the second task. Don't do that. Write again, like once you have compared it with the model answer, try to write it again. Try to, you know, write a final sample for yourself. So later on when you will be practicing for your final exams, those samples will be handy to you. And I do recommend everyone to make a list of common errors. Like today also, I have listed down some of the common errors for each one of you. So you should put it down on a piece of paper. And the list has to be made in two ways. One column should be a content error, right? What wrong information did I select? Or what, for example, Pankti today did not include the name of medication. So you can put it, you know, on a piece of paper that I must include medication if the nurse is supposed to monitor patient's medication. If she has nothing to do with medication, then it's fine. I can skip it. But the nurse is supposed to monitor. So how would she monitor if she doesn't know what kind of medication is the patient taking? So one column should be on the content error. And one column should be grammatical error. And do not too much worry about the grammar. Yeah, it's important to have grammatical accuracy, but don't worry too much about the grammar. Focus on the overall output, how the target reader would, you know, interpret the task that you are doing. Whether they would be able to understand what they need to do after receiving that letter. Focus on those things. And as far as grammar is concerned, you should be able to use active passive voice correctly. Appropriate tenses should be chosen. Those are important things, compound and complex sentences. And that is why we have put it in the form of video. So if you want to, you know, view it again and again, you can do that as well. If you are not getting the concepts clear, then